Good afternoon and welcome to the 14th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2023. We have apologies from Monica Lennon and Mark Ruskell, and I would also like to welcome at this stage Maggie Chapman, who joins us today for this meeting. We're delighted to have you here, and in line with convention, I'm going to give you the opportunity to ask your questions at the end, once the committee members have asked their questions. The first item on the agenda is a decision on taking business in private. At agenda item one, we would like to consideration of whether to take item three in private. Item three is consideration of evidence that we'll hear under item two. Are we agreed to take this item in private?
Agreed.
We are agreed. Thank you. Our next item of business is an evidence session as a part of our inquiry into Scotland's electricity infrastructure, inhibitor or enabler of our energy ambitions. On the 21st of March, the committee held its first evidence session with the energy industry stakeholders and experts. We have then heard from Ofgem, the statutory regulator for electricity markets in Great Britain. Since then, we've had an informal online event with energy entrepreneurs, which was really useful. And on Monday, some members of the committee were in Glasgow and at Whiteley Wind Farm as guests of Scottish Power. Today, we're going to explore the intersection of devolved and reserved responsibilities into relation to Scotland's future electricity infrastructure. I'm very pleased to welcome Andrew Bowie, MP, the Minister for Nuclear and Networks at the Department of Energy Security and Net Zero from the UK Government, and Jeremy Allen, the Director of Energy Portfolio Office, Department for Energy Security and Net Zero for the UK Government. Thank you, Andrew, for accepting our invitation. We're delighted to have you here. And before we begin, I believe you want to make an opening statement.
Thank you, Sir Edward. It's a pleasure to be back in the building and to be appearing in front of your committee. And I'd like to thank you for inviting me to this session, not only because it allows me to answer your question on the direction of travel for the UK government on energy policy and the intersection between devolved and reserved responsibilities, but it also has allowed me this morning to have constructive meetings on the Energy Bill, which received third reading in the House of Lords on Monday and was introduced to the House of Commons on Tuesday with Scottish Government colleagues, which were very constructive. The Energy Bill is the largest and most substantive bill going through Parliament in 16 years, and I'm delighted it's cross-party support, including from the Scottish Government. However, there are obviously slight creases that need to be ironed out, and look forward to working with all stakeholders as we move forward. My responsibilities, I'm sure you know, alongside taking the bill through, cover the grid, connectivity, nuclear and fusion. And can I say at the outset how much I and the Department for Energy Security and Net Zero welcome the draft energy strategy and your Just Transition Plan. It is obviously clear that we are on the same page on many of the issues. Renewables are desirable because they offer cheap and secure energy, not just zero carbon energy. And cheap and clean secure energy matters not just to keep the lights on, but because it is the engine of economic growth. Fossil fuels are at the mercy of global energy markets and vulnerable to bad actors like Vladimir Putin, as we've seen over this past year. And even though we were never dependent as a UK on Russian fossil fuels and have now banned their import entirely, the Ukraine invasion directly impacted our energy bills. Now, weaning ourselves off fossil fuels will be a massive change and challenge for the United Kingdom. And your inquiry rightly highlights that in order to build this energy future, a lot of difficult, sometimes unglamorous, delivery of new networks, infrastructure and market systems need to happen. So, using wind and solar most effectively will require being able to utilise and store excess energy when the weather is unfavourable and to bring in other sources when it is not. A big theme of your inquiry is growing investment in and deployment of hydrogen battery storage in CCUS, and in our recent Powering Up Britain set of publications, we committed to putting the policy framework for large-scale, long-duration storage in place by 2024, and we're also facilitating its deployment through the Smart Systems and flexibility plan jointly with options. Contracts for Difference remains our flagship policy for deployment of renewables and has been highly successful and world-leading. Key to maintaining a secure baseload of energy, of course, is nuclear. Many of the stations in our existing fleet are close to the end of their lifespan. To replace and extend that capability, the first nuclear power station in a generation is under construction at Hinkley Point C, an incredible project I visited just last month, with a groundbreaking investment of £700 million in Sizewell C in partnership with EDF. And we've established Great British Nuclear to deliver our nuclear programme, which is the first ever nuclear minister for the UK I'm particularly proud of. So I'd say that the overlap in our respective strategies between the UK Government and Scottish Government reflects reflects a reality that the strategic landscape for energy is now well developed and maturing. We have produced a series of publications over the past 3 years that have refined it in successive detail, and we are now into the granular detail of overcoming delivery barriers. For example, our review of electricity market arrangements is indeed making good progress. In summary, net zero energy security are two sides of the same coin. We have the strategic approach. Now it's up to ScotGov and UKGov to focus on delivery. And now, Sir Edward, I'm in your capable hands.
Well, we'll see at the end whether you stick to that belief. So the first questions are going to come from Liam Kerr. So, Liam, if you'd like to head off on this.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon to the panel. Andrew Bowie talked about the contracts for difference and their importance in stimulating and moving forward with renewables. But the UK government has recently launched a consultation on the contracts for difference regime, and my understanding is that there's a feeling that it would be best to move, a feeling amongst government, that it would be better to move from a straight consideration of bid price to incorporating other factors when bidding for such a contract. So supply chains, filling skills gap, innovation, that sort of thing. Minister, can you outline what are the benefits of a shift to that regime, but also perhaps what are the risks of moving to that regime?
Well, what I should say at the outset is that I cannot speak to the outcomes of a consultation that is ongoing, and obviously the government response to such consultation will come at the end of the process. However, you're absolutely right. I mean, in terms of the importance that Contracts for Difference has had in stimulating growth and investment in renewables, it is held up by industry across the world as being one of the best schemes on offer around the world in terms of countries that are serious about investing. And it compare it, for example, to the United States of America or France or Germany, and we're punching well above our weight. As a result of the CFD scheme, we have the first, second, third and fourth largest offshore wind farms in the world off the coast of Great Britain right now. But you know, speaking the round without actually wanting to prejudge the outcome of a consultation, it's absolutely essential if we are serious about ensuring the future of clean, green, renewable technology in the United Kingdom, be that in Scotland or elsewhere, that we have a UK-based supply chain so that we're not at the mercy of international markets moving forward, and that we have that skilled workforce at our fingertips. We're in a global competition here for labour, for materials, and it's really important that moving forward all these factors are taken into account when it comes to investing in future renewable technology. As I said, can't get too much into the detail of a consultation that's ongoing right now because the government will come to its view when that consultation has run its course, but all of these factors are central to how we are going to approach investment in renewables moving forward.
I'm very grateful, but I appreciate that whilst you wouldn't talk about a consultation, the government must have kind of horizon scanned and said what might be the outcomes of changing regimes, and you've talked about some of the benefits that might arise from changing regimes, such as on the skills and the supply chain. Couldn't there be a counter view that says that by changing the regime, you actually make projects more expensive and thus reduce the incentive for renewables coming forward?
Yeah, so look, the consultation is running. I don't want to be in a position where I even suggest that there may be a change of regime, because it could be that the consultation comes back and we decide not to change the regime, it moves forward. So I don't want to put any doubt in people's minds that we are minded to, in the immediate, change the regime. Obviously, we've just launched round five of the CFD scheme, and that is subject to all the procedures that are in place for rounds one through four, albeit taking in new and emerging technologies such as tidal in this next round. So, of course, any negatives would have to be thought of when it comes to responding to a consultation. It could well be that through the consultation it's proved that there are that any change to regime would prove disincentive to be a disincentive to investment in new renewables. And should that be the case, the government will obviously have to take a view on whether the benefits through investment in a UK-based supply chain, through ensuring that there is some investment in skills, working with universities, whatever that looks like, outweigh those negatives. However, as I said, we are not at the position right now of changing the scheme. I know that the reason for launching consultation was that as we've seen through the work that you as a committee have been doing, discussion to Scottish Government, Welsh Government and ourselves, there is an acknowledgement that, you know, because of that lack of a UK-based supply chain at the minute, because of the pressure on a small, skilled workforce, that, and because of the necessity to ensure that all of these pillars are in place to build a successful, sustainable, renewable energy industry moving forward in the UK, that we should possibly consider involving this in the process. But absolutely no decision has been taken. And it could well be that no decision is taken to change from the current regime. But it's important that we consult on all the options.
I'm very grateful. Obviously, without then prejudging, let's look at the potential positives. You talked in your opening remarks about the importance of storage. You talked about, obviously, batteries, hydrogen as a storage mechanism. If these changes to the contracts for difference regime were to come to pass, might such changes provide a better route to market for storage like hydrogen if they came forward? And in any event, what is the UK government doing to incentivise the development and rolling out of such storage opportunities?
Jeremy, from an official's point of view, do you want to take this one?
So I think we absolutely want to bring forward so-called flexible technologies that complement an increasingly renewables-based electricity system. We'll have to look at the individual technologies within flexibility on their merits and their economics to see what's the most appropriate way to make them commercial and allow them to compete in the market. At the moment, some forms of flexibility, like batteries, can enter into the capacity market. We are signalling that other forms like hydrogen may need a more tailored business model that will allow those early stage technologies to come to market and to prove themselves commercially in the way that the CFD did 5-10 years ago with forms of renewables. We also have a regime to bring forward interconnection with continental Europe as a form of flexibility. So I think we'll take different forms of flexibility case by case on their merits. What is the right regulatory framework, the right business models that bring those technologies to the fore? Because we do want to see them a significant part of our system.
One final question from me at this stage on something that you just brought up there, Jeremy Allen. It was that the you mentioned the capacity market. Yep. In the context of storage. Now, as I understand it, the UK government is proposing changes to the capacity market, which would include or better incentivise what we might call flexible technology to store, better allow them to compete in capacity market auctions. Now, this committee has heard that, for example, SME businesses producing batteries might find it difficult currently to enter that market. Will the proposed changes to the capacity market assist in that entry, and if so, how?
We are still considering the best approach to this moving forward. Obviously, we don't want to do anything that prevents development of technologies, especially when you look at some of the groundbreaking work that's being done by SMEs. This is a point of discussion, in fact, this morning with Scottish Government officials, and it's something that officials have been commissioned on my behalf to look into, because where we do want to look at how the capacity market operates and whether or not it's delivering what we need to deliver for the ambitious targets that we've set. What we don't want to do is just by quirk of drafting or whatever it is, put off companies from continuing to develop these new technologies moving forward. So all of that will be taken into consideration, but no decision has been taken as yet. And as I said, this is still very much at official level discussions. In terms of ministerial discussion, we are not very close to making a decision on this at the minute.
Grateful to you both, convener.
Thanks very much, Liam. The next questions come from Ash Regan. Ash.
Thank you, convener. Good afternoon to the panel. What role does the UK government envisage for hydropower in the future energy system?
Well, the future energy system, we're going to need a wide range of technologies for our energy base load moving forward. And we see that at the minute through our investment in offshore wind, onshore wind, nuclear, the fact we've ring-fenced £10 million in the current CFD auction process for tidal. So, all of these energy sources are going to be part of a wider mix when it comes to developing and moving us away from our reliance on fossil fuels, including hydro.
Okay. So you mentioned the Scottish Government's draft energy strategy, which I believe you welcome some of the content in that. You'll probably be aware that there was a request in there to provide, and I'll quote, appropriate market mechanisms for hydropower to ensure the full potential of this sector is realised. So I wanted to ask you if you broadly support that request or that call, and if so, what work is being done to support investment in that sector, and when will we see proposals for that appropriate support mechanism coming forward?
So, answer to the first question, yes. Absolutely do support it. Secondly, discussions are ongoing right now between officials at the Department for Energy Security and Net Zero and Treasury colleagues as to how best we can create a framework to deliver hydro technology to market. These are early stage discussions and I don't foresee any announcement being made in the immediate future, but there are discussions underway and I'm very keen, although it doesn't fall directly under my portfolio, although it does in the wider conversation about grid and the wider energy mix, to see us moving forward and supporting these some might describe nascent technologies moving forward.
Okay, so if I could just ask you just to follow up, you know, an idea of immediate and so on can mean different things to different people. Would you be able to put any kind of time frame onto that? Would it be this year? Do you see it being more something that would be for next year?
What I can do we can write to you with further information on what the timetable might be for that. Because okay. I don't have that information at my fingertips, but I'm happy to give you more information on that.
That would be great. Thank you very much.
Great, thank you.
I'm going to bring in the Deputy Convener, Fiona.
Thank you and welcome to the Committee Minister. On the issue of hydro, obviously it's not nascent.
No, it's not nascent. It's
we've had hydro for a long time. But in order to get the scale of expansion, and there are significant expansion proposals, as you'll be aware of, mm-hmm. in Scotland, that are being held up, basically. You say there's talks going on, mm-hmm. but they are being held up. So is there an understanding of the need for pace in this, in order to do exactly what we're saying, as you heard from your colleague, about the flexibility, particularly around ensuring that we have the access to this fantastic resource that we have as part of our mix?
Yeah, absolutely. I would suggest that having a Scottish MP within the department sort of lends itself to moving these things on faster than probably would otherwise be the case, because it's quite clear, given the proximity that we all have to the amazing possibilities of development of hydro at scale, that these things move forward. So, yes, there is an acknowledgement that we need to move forward faster, as there is with the investment in all these the technologies that we're speaking about. You know, there is a requirement to do this. You know, we need Scotland to reach its net zero target by 2045, so the UK as a whole reaches its net zero target of 2050, because the two targets are interlinked, and that will involve further investment in all of these technologies. And so pace is very much a major part of the consideration when we're moving through discussions on all of this. However, we also have to work within what is, you know, the art of the possible, and we do have, you know, we are working very far on a whole range of different areas, but this is certainly an area that we are keen to move forward as fast as we possibly can.
And I'm sure you are, but it's the Treasury that are making decisions, I think,
yes.
From what I can hear. What do they need to speed up their decision-making?
As I said, I will be writing to Ms Reagan with more information on this going forward. And any pressure that this committee can bring to bear on the Treasury on any issue, actually, I'd be most welcome for that input.
That's an interesting thought. We'll move on to the next questions then, which come from Jackie Dunbar. Jackie.
Thank you. Good afternoon, panel. We are seeing that the US and the EU support for green hydrogen is being ramped up, and I think everybody would agree that we've got to make sure that the UK doesn't lose its competitive advantage in that. So can I ask you what work has been done to ensure that any existing competitive advantage we do have in hydrogen is maintained and also enhanced?
Yeah, so hydrogen is one of the key solutions, we think, to getting us to our net zero ambition by 2050. In the upcoming energy bill, which I actually have in front of me here, we are legislating to allow for hydrogen village trials. We are legislating for the regulation of transport and storage of hydrogen. We are moving forward. It's our ambition as the United Kingdom government to deliver up to 10 gigawatts of low-carbon hydrogen production capacity by 2030, and at least half of this will come from electrolytic hydrogen, drawing on the scale of up to UK offshore wind and other renewables, and indeed new nuclear. So we are putting a lot of emphasis on this. We saw in the Powering Up Britain announcement, we are supporting hydrogen projects across the United Kingdom, and it's an area of technology. Now, it's not without controversy. Some people do dispute that hydrogen will be hydrogen for heating, for example, will ever be effective or will be cost effective. This is why we're legislating to enable these trials to go ahead, so that we can prove whether technology actually works at scale, is affordable, and might complement some of the other ways that we're seeking to heat homes and businesses in the future. But no, we're determined to... I mean, look at Germany. They're making huge strides forward. Yeah. We want to be doing exactly the same. This is a starting point. We know what the end point needs to be, and so yeah, we're investing a lot of time and money in hydrogen moving forward. And some of the developments are very exciting. The village trials, for example, not without controversy, but really will be, I think, the moment that we're able to see hydrogen from a heating perspective, from a domestic use perspective, really coming through, should they be successful.
Okay. Can I ask what the UK government is doing to develop a regulatory regime for the hydrogen production and storage? And can you give me a timescale for this?
Yeah.
So the bill that the Minister referred to currently in House of Commons is creating the regulatory framework for the production of hydrogen. So we're very keen to see that move through its parliamentary passage. It provides a clear regulatory framework against which we're also providing funding, exchequer funding, and then in time funding via the consumer bill that matches an incentive to bring forward production against a clear regulatory framework in which operators have the confidence to invest.
Because without that regulatory framework, which this bill establishes, we won't be able to do any of the exciting developments that are being talked of right now. So this is absolutely key, which is one of the reasons why there's such broad cross-party support for this bill.
Okay, thank you.
We have the electricity allocation round, which we will decide on the first one towards the end of this year. We've announced in Powering Up Britain that we will run a second round of electrolytic allocation, significant funding behind that to really ramp up production in advance of that 2030 target that the Minister mentioned.
Okay. If I can, you said earlier that it's for the UK to meet its net zero targets by 2050, that Scotland needs to meet ours by 2045. And we've heard in the committee that the carbon capture storage is vital for us to be able... I think you know what's coming because you've got your arms crossed. It's vital that we get it. And the CCC has said that we do not have the necessary powers in Scotland to get there. So can I ask you... when will the Scottish CCS cluster receive the required support from the UK government?
So this is the Acorn cluster, the Scottish cluster, Peterhead. Well, Acorn has received £40 million of UK government support to date to move the programme forward. It was, as you know, the reserve for Track 1. And in March, we announced the Track 2 process in which Acorn is the leading contender for that process. So I would be overwhelmingly delighted should Acorn be successful through the Track 2 process. But we've got to let that process take its course. We've announced it. It is still our stated ambition to have Track 2 up and running by 2030. And it's absolutely vital, as you said, to Scotland's 2045 net zero ambition and the UK's 2050 net zero ambition to get more carbon capture and storage on stream across the whole United Kingdom. We've seen the Track 1 developments moving forward incredibly positively. It would be brilliant to see Acorn do the same. But it needs to be subject to the Track 2 process that we're working through. I'm delighted that we started moving that forward.
Can I push you a little bit on that?
Of course
you
can.
Do you have a timescale for it so that we can actually... because it's good to hear that it's now part of the Track 2, but when will we see it actually be up and going?
There will be an update for all parties in the summer.
Okay, thank you.
Nice try. I'm not sure you're going to get any further than that. Just, Minister, just before we leave hydrogen, one of the problems with hydrogen from the briefings that I've been receiving is the fact that you lose a lot of electricity, up to 30 to 40% of changing electricity into hydrogen. And then you have quite a high loss when you transmit or you convert that back into electricity. And there is the issue, of course, of moving hydrogen around, which can't necessarily be done in the gas network that we've had. I mean, we've heard some evidence on the committee that it can be, but it can only be part of a diluted or diluted within the gas that's going around. So my question to you is, how is the government and how do you see what encouragement being given to develop this to A, minimise losses and B, make transmission of hydrogen around the UK easier?
Well, again, the regulatory framework for transmission is included in the bill, so all of that will be covered in there. But in terms of investment in the network, you're absolutely right. The National Gas Grids Project Union, in terms of developing the network across the UK to be safely improved so that it can deliver hydrogen across the UK in the future, is very much underway right now. That is a project. It's a project for them, which we, you know, take a very keen interest. But you're absolutely right. There are questions around whether hydrogen is viable, and that is why we are legislating to enable these trials to take place. That's why we're supporting the work of National Gas to look at what they need to do with the network to make it safe. You know, there are some concerns out there about that. We need to address all of these in the round. That is why we're taking all the action that we've spoken about so far, because we do share the loss when it converted, you know, the concerns about diluting the safety frameworks that we have within the grid right now. All of that comes into the discussion when we're talking about what we're going to do if hydrogen is going to be part of the mix moving forward.
Okay, so the gas network, though, if it's going to be used, pipelines to use to transport hydrogen, will have to be transferred from a metal piping system to a poly piping system, for lack of a better description.
Yeah, no, you're right.
And I'm interested to know if the government is planning how they can plan to assist driving that transfer out.
Well, we're fully supportive of what National Gas Grids are doing and the investment that they are making alongside the hydrogen industry, because they are obviously very keen, as are we, supportive of ensuring that it is safe, deliverable and cost-effective. Those discussions, you know, continue, and approaches to the government for support in that regard will be looked at on merit as they come in.
Okay, so the final part of my question on this, that if the existing infrastructure that we've got for gas transmission isn't that easily converted to hydrogen, does that say that there's an important future for gas across the United Kingdom?
Well, there is going to be an important future for gas. I mean, I don't know what the stats are today, but on some days, gas is responsible for 55 to 60%, as we sit here right now in 2023, for our overall energy baseload. So there will be an important role for gas to play. We would love to see that reduced. That involves, of course, everything we talk about, new renewable technologies, nuclear, all the rest of it, to reduce that. But, you know, it is important to stress that we won't be turning those taps off tomorrow. And so gas plays an eminently, hugely pivotal, central role when it comes to providing the heating and power generation needs in the immediate future in the UK.
OK, thank you. The next questions come from the Deputy Convener, Fiona.
So you said that electricity market arrangements are not glamorous, but I agree with you, they are essential. So could you set out what you see as the key risks to infrastructure investment of the current electricity market arrangements?
In terms of what specifically, sorry, Deputy Convener, are you speaking of investment?
So clearly the market for renewables will be extensive and can be extensive, but it needs certain decisions to be made, which obviously you're considering just now. But if you look at what's happening in the US with the IRA, when you look at what's happening in Europe with the Green Deal, that opportunity we have could be closing if we don't make sure that we've got the market arrangements that we need. But clearly that belies the fact that underneath that we know that the current electricity market arrangements are not working to ensure that scale of investment happens rapidly. So what's your assessment of the risks?
Well, I think there are huge risks. In terms of IRA and the possible response from the European Union and others to that, whereas we welcome the United States of America moving at pace and at scale and investing in clean and green technologies, I think we all recognise that the United States has a leading role to play when we are talking about reducing carbon emissions across the world. It obviously has created or caused some concern within the United Kingdom and other countries, including the European Union, Korea, Singapore, Japan, where we have been leading the way in terms of investment in new renewable technologies and everything else. So we are in discussions with the United States right now as to how we best respond to that at an international level. At a domestic level, we are head and shoulders above where the reason the United States of America are throwing so much money, and it's welcome that they are taking it seriously at this issue right now, is because they have been underinvesting for the last 10, 15, 20 years, whereas the UK has been moving forward at pace. The Contracts for Difference has been transformational, as I said. The big thing that I am concerned about in this entire sphere is its grid capacity, connection times, and planning and consenting, all of which is actually holding up further investment in all of these technologies as it stands right now. It's all well and good, I've already said, it's great we've got the first, second, third and fourth largest wind farms off the coast of Great Britain right now, but if you can't get the power from those wind farms into the grid, then what's the point in building them in the first place? So we've commissioned Nick Windsor to deliver an independent review and report. He will be delivering that in June. I'm glad to say that in March this year, I held a round table with all interest parties, including the Scottish Government, Crown Estate Scotland, distributors, hydrogen champion, the wind farm champion, everybody that was in any way involved, National Grids, they were the ESO, were the, anyway, we are all of agreement that we need to look at how we develop an overarching plan moving forward to develop the grid, to modernise it and to get it ready for the fourfold increase in demand that's going to be put on it in the next few years. We're not where we need to be right now. That is absolutely true. We've also commissioned the Holistic Network Design follow-up exercise. That will also be working through its processes in the next few months. When Nick Windsor's review is published and when the Holistic Network Design follow-up exercise, which definitely needs a better title, concludes its processes, we will then take a view on how we best proceed. But everybody involved at every stage in the process is committed to doing what we can to improve the grid. It's non-negotiable. It's not a nice to have. It's not something that the government can go, well, we should be improving the grid, but we can't. It's not a case of we cannot afford or we don't want it. We need to do it because we're going to be turning. We're going to be turning off or turning away from fossil fuels. There will be a huge increase in demand on electricity, and the network is not in any place ready to cope as it stands right now, which is why we're taking this so seriously.
So my next question leads on from that. So what is the expected timescale for completion and implementation of that transmission network systems change and your review of the electricity market arrangements?
The Nick Windsor's review is due to publish in June. I don't know the recommendations he will be publishing. It is wholly independent, but we will be then taking a view. And we'll be moving this is not something that we can just park and come back to. As I said, fourfold increase in the next 5-10 years. We need to act on this now. So we will be with his recommendations. In terms of the HND follow-up exercise, what's the timescale for that?
I will check on that. I think we want to work at pace, but we've already started following HND last year. We are seeing the regulator working with transmission network operators to identify those projects that may be accelerated. I think something like £20 billion worth of network investment is being accelerated to meet the HND aspiration of being more efficient, quicker consenting, quicker connections. So. The process is starting, and where Nick Windsor or the HND follow-up suggests sensible ways forward. I think ministers will want to do that.
Yeah, absolutely. And of course, Ofgem has a role to play here as well. The connection times, the queue procedure, you know, how we better, you know, reform that. The farcical situation where you have to pay to come off the waiting list at the minute, clogging up the system by people who may not actually want to deliver or have any plans to develop in the near future, preventing those who do have plans and are ready to plug in. So we need to address all of that, and that's what we will be doing over the summer as soon as Nick Windsor's review and the HND fallback exercise is completed.
And can I just press you in terms of your decision making, once you had the recommendations, what would you see as being a successful timescale for you're making decisions that will make a difference, because the risks of this are very, very high.
For fear of stepping outside my brief, because there will be more than just myself responsible for making this decision, I would be pressing for as soon as is physically possible.
And in terms of going back to the kind of issue about the risks of not being prompt on acceleration of all these decision-making. You mentioned a number of issues. Planning consents, we acknowledge in this committee, something we'll pursue with our minister here as well. But the issue around SMEs and supply chains, if the markets are really opening up, now for good reason, and now in the States and the EU in particular, you know, we have to make sure we've got people that have got the skills. It's not just the infrastructure. Is that something you acknowledge as well?
Yes, absolutely. That's why I said it's a global race. Mm-hmm. A small pool of highly skilled individuals across the world who every country are chasing to work to develop their new energy technologies. I was at the Green Trade and Investment Expo in Gateshead in the north of England in October last year, and it was genuinely mind-blowing, the sheer scale of UK-based technologies, innovation and ambition in the green technology sphere, and it's absolutely essential if we're going to retain that in the UK that we invest not only in those technologies, not only in the grid as we're speaking right now, but actually in training up the workforce within the United Kingdom so that we have that pool of talent to ensure that we continue to develop and scale the technologies which frankly are world leading. A company there who is going to be the first ever glass recycle deliverer in Brazil, for example, you know, because of the technology he's been able to develop that would make it, you know, workable within that country. Stuff like that, which we can be really proud of developing within the UK. We won't do that unless we invest in skills. And so working with the Department for Education, Department for Work and Pension, the devolved administrations in Wales and here in Scotland, obviously, a whole piece on how we develop those skills is absolutely central to what I want to achieve, if I achieve anything, by the time I have left this particular job.
I won't reference that. I will reference, the important...
I hope will not be for some time.
You walked into that.
I did.
So the issue of competitive advantage currently is key. We have got world-leading skills and experience. Scotland has the fantastic renewables opportunities in terms of the wind that can be generated. It's not been serviced properly by the grid. But one of the things that is not competitive, as you understand, will be transmission charges for the generators. So why, when we know that we've got increasing competition elsewhere coming at us, where that window of opportunity is there, we have to take it. But in terms of transmission charges for our generators, that's a real disincentive for investment. So what can be done about that? What has been done more recently? And do you recognise that the generation of renewable energy in Scotland is currently a severe disadvantage from elsewhere in the UK, but also across the rest of Europe?
I don't accept that in full, because, you know, transmission charges are higher in Scotland just because of the geographical nature of the effort it takes to, you know, deliver electricity across the challenging geography that we have in the country. And if we were to reduce the transmission charges, you know, industry and indeed Ofgem would argue that that would pass a higher burden on to consumers. And as it is right now, consumers on the whole, although not exclusively, on the whole, pay a lower transmission charge here in Scotland than they do in in other parts of the United Kingdom. So I don't accept that argument in its entirety. However, where there are disincentives to further investment, we would be looking to do what we can to resolve that. I mean, it is primarily a role for Ofgem in that field. I know that they appeared before the committee a few weeks ago, so I'm aware that they are aware that they have work to do on this, and I wouldn't like to prejudge any work that they are doing on this. But I don't know if it's as much of a disincentive as you say, given the speed and the scale at which renewable energy has been invested in the UK up to this point.
And Kevin, my final question is, what will the impact of the establishment of the future systems operator have on that whole energy systems planning? Yeah. Will the FSO provide that certainty about what, where, when infrastructure needs to be built? You use the term we quite a lot, but it's private companies that are going to be investing the billions of investment. So what do you think that can do to provide that certainty for business to invest?
I suppose to address your point about using the term we, I mean, I suppose I'm sort of thinking almost in that sort of Team UK, because again, sitting around that table with private industry, with the ESO, with National Grid, with Crown Estate, with Crown Estate Scotland, with the devolved administrations from here and in Wales and Northern Ireland, it was clear that we were all sort of one team in terms of where we want to go. So when I say we, I'm sort of talking in the round in that regard. In terms of the FSO, we are in the process of establishing the FSO as it is right now. Again, the regulatory framework for it is within this bill. Again, proving the need to get this bill in the statute book as quickly as possible. We are still looking to for the FSO to be up and running in the first half of 2024. There are significant challenges to that, but we are determined to overcome them. It will be central in terms of delivering this overall plan for investment in the grid across GB. It is going to be the focal point, the lead, the through which everything will stem. And that's why it's important that we set this up. And ESO, I have to say, National Grid ESO, have been incredibly willing, forthcoming, and indeed instrumental in getting us to where we are right now. Whereas we are at the stage of discussing contracts and pensions and all the rest, we are that advanced. The FSO is coming, it's coming soon, and it will be pivotal to what we're trying to achieve.
Thank you.
Okay, just before we leave this, Minister, I just want to make it abundantly clear, I've done it in previous meetings, that as a farmer I've got transmission lines across my land, 11 kV, 33 kV, and I'm in negotiation for 132 kV transmission lines. So power lines do cross my land. I do have an interest in them, but the issue I found interesting there was the fact that you were saying the scale of power line building that we're going to have to meet our requirements. There is a particular outcry in the Highlands at the moment about the latest lines that are coming through and the fact that there's been incredibly poor negotiation between SSEN and the people on the ground. Do you think there's a piece of work that needs doing, A, to make sure people understand the need for these lines, and do you think that there is a better way than power companies just using compulsory powers to go in and try and place these lines without proper consultation?
It's a really difficult one, Chairman, because you know we do need this infrastructure to be built across the whole of Great Britain if we are going to reach the targets we have set. But it's absolutely essential, and I've said this since day one, that we take the public with us on this journey. Everybody out there in the round accepts, supports even, the need for this country to get to net zero. What I don't think we have done, and when I say we at this stage, I mean ourselves, I would suggest Scottish Government, industry, has explained to people exactly what this will mean, exactly what getting to net zero will actually mean, what, you know, moving away from fossil fuel-based energy baseload will mean in terms of energy transmission networks and the investment in the grid and the deployment at scale of the infrastructure that we're going to need. I cannot, because it's far out with my remit, speak to planning in Scotland. And this particular line is for SSEN working with Ofgem to engage with local communities. What I would say is, in the same way that we are approaching onshore wind, for example, south of the border, is that we need to bring communities with us where these investments are going to take place. What does fall into my preserve as UK Minister for Networks is the developments at scale that we're going to have to see in parts of East Anglia, for example. And right now there's a huge volume of work being done both by the companies involved in that development, by government, by local communities and by local members of parliament to engage with the communities on the community benefits that might result. We've launched a consultation on community benefits from the investment in infrastructure we're going to need to see what we can do for communities that might be adversely impacted by this infrastructure that we're going to have to build. There is an acknowledgement that we have to build it. But what we can't, I mean, I really can't get involved in the detail of this Spittal-Tabuli issue right now. But
I'm not going to. I'm asking about a generality of taking people with us 100%. On the net zero journey, and also making sure that all those involved in it buy into the consultation. It can't be too heavy-handed.
I completely agree.
Okay. Just as you mentioned, Minister, that we have discussed with Ofgem, and one of the questions was raised by other people was whether their statutory duty should include the wording achieving net zero. They said they didn't need it. Other people said they did. Do you have a view?
You won't be surprised, Chairman, that this is something that has been discussed at length within my office, and not least because there was an amendment to the energy bills in the House of Lords last week, which would insert this into the bill. It is being discussed within government right now. As it stands at the moment, we do not believe that Ofgem should have a statutory duty to include net zero in their remit. However, we are looking at the amendments that were placed in the Lords, and government is discussing a way forward as we speak.
So if it's not needed, I'm going to push you a wee bit on this. If you don't believe it's needed, do you believe that they are doing that, and will you direct them to do that, even if it doesn't appear in their remit, the wording?
I don't want to prejudge discussions going on elsewhere in government right now. All I can say is that we oppose the amendment put in the House of Lords. However, we are discussing how Ofgem can best support our move towards net zero moving forward.
Okay, I guess that's an ongoing situation.
It is.
We'll have to monitor that. Liam, did you want to come back in on a question?
Yes, thank you, Convener. Just very briefly, I thought the Deputy Convener's concern about grid connections points were well made, and it was just to follow up or clarify, if I may, just something on that. You answered the Deputy Convener talking about grid connections and the ability to get into the grid by saying that there's this Nick Windsor review happening. This committee's had it suggested that perhaps the larger generation companies could, in theory, make a speculative application for grid capacity and almost bank that connection. Do you recognise that as either possible or indeed happening? And in any event, what is the UK government going to do to ensure that SMEs the more innovative companies looking for that connection can definitely get access?
Yes, it's possible. Yes, it's happening. This is a part of the Windsor review, and we'll be acting on his recommendations when it is published. It's essential that there is not a blockage in the system as a result of actors who may, some might suggest, be doing what they're doing in bad faith.
Grateful. Convener.
Right, just before I come to Maggie Chapman, the clerk's reminded me when I did give my original declaration, I reminded everyone about my power lines that go through the farm. Of course, we receive a standard way leave payment for it, as does everyone else. So there are payments involved. Not very much, Jackie, just in case you're worried that it will be bigger than you imagine. It's not. Maggie, you've got some questions you'd like to ask.
Thank you very much, and thank you for letting me come into this meeting this afternoon. Good afternoon to the panel. Thank you for being here. I appreciate what you've already said, Andrew Bower, this afternoon about the UK Energy Bill going through Parliament and several reviews ongoing and yet to report, and those timescales are various and forthcoming. So there is some limit to some of your answers, perhaps, in some of these issues. You referenced the Scottish Government's a draft energy strategy and just transition plan, and within that you'll know that the very, very clear commitment to maximising community benefit, not only in terms of renewable energy developments, but also, as we've already heard, localising transmission, distribution, connectivity and all of that, and shared ownership. I suppose, given what you've already said this afternoon and following on from Fiona Hislop's questioning around the FSO, how do you see the FSO's role in facilitating those kinds of community benefits in a material way for particularly rural communities?
So the FSO, as it stands, is being developed as we speak. So its remit, although I've spoken in the round about what we want the FSO to do, its specific remit when it comes to specific areas like that will be for discussions as we develop the FSO over the course of the next few months. So I'm afraid, I don't know, Jeremy, if you want to say much more on that. But
I think we would look to the FSO to provide the strategic direction for a system that is net zero and secure and low cost. More specifics around community benefit, I think we'll have to see as the organisation gets up and running. And clearly, at the moment, ministers would look to the network operators themselves working in the regulatory framework to take account of these factors, and hence the consultation that the minister mentioned around networks. We, within England, we've launched consultations on community benefit for onshore wind, for instance. So it's very much a topic that we would expect market participants to address either through the regulatory framework as it stands or via the various consultations that we support to get technologies deployed.
Mr. Jordan, you made a point about, there are some things to which I cannot give a full answer right now because reviews are ongoing or investigations or consultations, and the Energy Bill is still moving through its stages in the House. I'd be very keen to come back when an opportunity when I can give fuller answers. The Department for Energy Net Zero, it was only founded in February. We've achieved quite a lot in a very short period of time, and there's a lot coming in the very near future, to which I think would answer a lot of the questions that have been posed here today. So when these publications post-summer, when all of this, we hope, the Energy Bill's on the statute book, I'd be happy to come back.
Okay, thank you for that. Jeremy, you mentioned there two avenues, the regulatory frameworks and consultations, obviously the opportunities for communities to respond and influence consultations. Do either of you see any likelihood of the need to adjust the regulatory frameworks? And if so, in what directions?
I mean, that's a very good question. But
I think we would wait for the outcome of consultations to see what the evidence tells us is the appropriate way. We wouldn't want to preempt that process.
And I suppose, again, I might get a similar answer. And I appreciate it's early days.
It's unfortunate. I apologise.
I'm not trying to be awkward. Some others around the table may think that it's just my nature. But I suppose one of the key challenges we've talked about, and I know the committee has heard about, and we hear it quite often, are the issues of connecting to the grid that actually are problematic in terms of resilience. And you will be very familiar with some of the resilience issues and failures during Storm Arwen and other similar events. What are the opportunities in this body of work, whether it's legislation, whether it's reviews, in this body of work to actually think outside the box or beyond the grid, if you like, so we can actually have local, community-owned, resilient energy supplies that aren't dependent on infrastructure that might be several tens of miles away, or controlled several hundreds of miles away. How do we build resilience into an energy system, an electricity system that is not only net zero but also fit for the future and doesn't rely on or isn't subject to grid failures?
Great question, Ms. Chapman. And I think before going any further, and you may have preempted the answer, but I think we should maybe, and it would be remiss of us not to acknowledge the huge work that SSEN in particular put in post-Storm Arwen to ensure that the grid is more robust, to ensure that the network, is more robust and more resilient and future-proofed. We saw in the subsequent storms that came after Arwen, in the immediate aftermath of Arwen, we did not see the failure that we saw during Arwen, and indeed last winter, despite some inclement weather at some points, we did not see the failures that we saw in the previous year. And I know, speaking as a local constituency MP, the engagement that SSEN have had with communities locally has been far and above what had gone before.
Yes.
So, so I think we should probably acknowledge the work that they have done to make it more resilient. Again, subject consultation, review process and the bill, your remarks as a party, the party of government in the UK right now has had support for community energy and locally owned energy in every manifesto since 2010. We want to go further. We absolutely are sympathetic to what you suggest, but I would like to see these processes work their way through before we actually take any decisions on how we might be able to best do that.
I suppose one of the key points, and maybe one of the arguments for not seeing this as a nice add-on extra at the end of the process, yeah, is it might actually do away with the need for some of the other issues we've been talking about.
Yeah.
You know, if you have self-sufficient, in energy terms, islands or rural communities,
yeah,
we don't need to worry about some of the broader issues around transmission and distribution because...
Yeah.
It's there.
Yeah,
it's right there. And I'm not seeing necessarily that kind of strategic thinking in terms of the off-grid, or off-grid is maybe the wrong phrase to use, the beyond-grid,
yeah,
supply, distribution, transmission,
yeah,
and use.
No, that's a very good point, actually. And that is... If you aren't seeing that, then maybe you should be seeing that. And so that's... I will take that away. And... as well as writing to Ms. Reagan, I might write to you in terms of what we are intending on doing in that, because we are sympathetic to it very much.
That'd be very helpful.
Yeah, no, thank
you.
Just to remind you, if you are going to write in, could you write in to the committee, and we'll make sure it's distributed to Maggie, because she's not technically part of the committee, but the committee would be grateful to hear the answers.
Very good, Chair.
So I think the Deputy Convener's got some more questions.
Just a few follow-up questions. I'm also interested in that localisation, mm-hmm, and decentralisation. We've heard from stakeholders that are innovators, that, mm-hmm, in diversity they need flexibility,
yep,
and obviously the idea of more localised grids, connections, could make a big difference, mm-hmm, in that area. Similarly, if we're looking at green hydrogen and big industrial plants, for example, cement plants or big users of industry, mm-hmm, having that, whether it's off-grid, different grid or whatever, the distribution aspect of it is absolutely key as well, mm-hmm, not least within the geography of Scotland.
Yeah, of course.
And then thirdly, that point about community, we talk about community benefit, mm-hmm, but community value would be to have more immediate and direct access to reliable and affordable, mm-hmm, renewable green energy. So to what extent, therefore, is everything you've been talking about today, does any of it address this, and how do you think it will address these issues?
I hope that just about everything we've talked about today will help address, maybe not the specific issue, but the issues in the round faced by those in rural communities who are out with, what was your phrase, Ms. Chapman, not off-grid?
Beyond grid.
I think it's good people use that. I hope. Specifically, well, look, Nick Windsor's review is ongoing. There are many consultations out there who are still to report back to government, to which we will have a response. In terms of what we're doing specifically, as I've already promised to write through the convener to Ms. Chapman, that copy of that letter, I'm sure will be available for you to see, and I'm very happy to engage and work with the committee and indeed other parties to see what more we can do, because there will be a whole element of devolved responsibility in here as well, I am absolutely sure, especially through planning and consenting, etc. So I'm very keen to do that moving forward.
Okay. And then another question I wanted to follow up on is, as you said, in the House of Lords, you at that point, the UK government had rejected the proposition of giving a statutory responsibility to Ofgem to achieve net zero. Now, bearing in mind that decarbonising energy is essential to achieving net zero, which is essential to tackle climate change, why wouldn't you? But it would be quite helpful if you could maybe give us on the record what your rationale is in currently rejecting that.
The rationale for being opposed to that amendment would be that we wouldn't want to do anything that would dilute or distract from Ofgem's primary role, which is to act on behalf of the consumer, which is their number one statutory duty. So that is the argument for not diluting that by including a duty on net zero. That was the rationale for opposing the amendment. That continues to be the government position as it is right now. However, I can pledge to you that discussions are ongoing as to how we can support Ofgem in their ability to act to support our ambitions re net zero, which will include Ofgem allowing companies to make anticipatory investment in various fields to ensure that we can deploy, for example, offshore wind at the scale we need to.
So that becomes an argument of whether it's in the interests of consumers to have renewable energy full stop.
They do have a duty to consumers of the future, which if Ofgem were sitting in front of you, which I know they have been in the recent past, they may, although I want to put words in their mouth, they may argue that that would include or might cover the net zero duty from their perspective. However, Deputy Convener, what I will say is that, this is a very live issue within government right now, and so it is being discussed. As I said, we will have to have a response to the amendment placed in the Lords when it comes to Commons Act.
And then finally, and I understand it's in the committee's interest, obviously the energy bill it's important we have this energy bill, but there are obviously issues within it. I'm very pleased to hear you were talking with different stakeholders and also separately or together with the Scottish Government, mm-hmm. because the committee has looked at the energy bill, as you'll be aware. We produced a report on an LCM, and one of the concerns we have, and we've reflected here today, the importance of having investment in infrastructure, speeds of decision, and also speeds of deployment of infrastructure investment. And one of the concerns we have, and it's in paragraph 71 of our report into the Energy Bill and the LCM, is the combination of the Energy Bill and the Levelling Up and the Regeneration Bill, and in terms of mitigations, for example, giving powers under the Levelling Up Bill to the Environment Secretary to make decisions. Now, the Environment Secretary of State is a UK minister. Environment is devolved. So one of our concerns is the overlapping of this matrix of rules and obligations and permissions could actually have a chilling, we use that word, chilling impact on investment, which none of us want to have. So whether, I don't know if that is your direct responsibility or was subject to the discussions today, but is that something that is on your radar, because it's in everybody's interest to get decision-making promptly and securely, and we have concerns about the combination of these two bills.
It very much is. Without wanting to speak to the specifics, because I obviously don't want to speak outside the confidential nature, as you will know from your past experience of intergovernmental discussions, it very much is on the radar. We don't want to do anything through this bill or elsewhere that would slow down approvals and consenting process for developing or investing in the technologies that we need and at the scale and the pace that we need, and nothing in the bill will seek, and if it does at the minute, we will look to where we can improve it to do anything that might delay the approvals process going forward. And I should also say that nothing in the bill will seek to take any powers away from Scottish Government ministers as it stands right now in terms of where they have responsibility for wholly devolved areas.
And it's where we're suggesting seeking consent in devolved areas rather than consulting would make a big difference in this.
As I said, these are live discussions ongoing right now.
Listen, thank you very much.
I think that was slightly out with the remit of today, Deputy Convener, but I gave you a bit of leeway. So unless there's any other questions, I just have an observation. I mean, as we are moving forward in Scotland with our energy ambitions with using power, I mean, I look at the moment that 32% of the power across GB comes from wind at the moment, 5.9% from solar. Obviously not hugely evident up here, but there's a huge reliance still on gas and a baseload as well from nuclear, either from UK resources or from French resources. My question to you is that we do want to use renewable energy where we can, but it's just to be sure in our mind that the plans include the ability to use a baseload if and when we need it across the United Kingdom.
Yes, they do, absolutely. And as I said, moving forward, the UK's energy baseload will be made up of a wide mix of different energy streams. We cannot be in the position where we are wholly reliant. We've seen, as a result of international, predominantly Vladimir Putin's action in Ukraine, what happens if you are overly reliant on one source of energy. You are at the behest of the international markets in terms of the price of that energy, and that is what's happened this winter over gas, which is why the UK government's had to spend £1,500 per person in mitigating the effects of the high energy bills. A wide range of energy technologies will be required to create that wide energy baseload moving forward, so we're never again at the whim of international markets through the winter. That includes everything we've spoken about today, as well as, and you would expect me to say this, as the UK's First Minister for Nuclear, a new nuclear future for this country as well.
Including the ability to transmit it to where it's needed.
Absolutely, 100%. That, the grid connectivity, transmission networks, the huge challenge. Nobody is underestimating the challenge that we've got. What is good, as I said, is that from UK government, Scottish government, industry, and all the bodies that are interested and involved in this, we all acknowledge the work, the investment, and the speed at which we're going to have to develop the grid if we're going to meet our targets. And we have to meet our targets.
OK. I think that is all the questions that we've got around the table. Minister, I'd like to thank you for coming up here, and I know you don't need any excuse to get closer to your home patch, for lack of a better description, but it's good to see you, and it's good to see you answering questions which maybe not initially have been part of where you thought you were going to be, but opening it, answering them with openness, and I appreciate your time. And I look forward to the correspondence that the committee will receive on the areas that you've undertaken to. And our clerks will, of course, remind you of those areas after the meeting. But that is all we have for you. We are going to go into private session, so thank you very much for your time today.
You.